Good morning. Welcome. My name is Dave Massell. I'm a professor of history at UVM, a conference co-organizer. And before turning the mic over to my good dean, Bill Falls, I simply want to point out two adjustments in the program agenda, which is found just on the inside cover of your program. In the welcoming remarks, which is what I'm doing right now, Marie-Claude Francoeur is unfortunately unable to join us at the last minute, but it is our pleasure to welcome Quebec Minister Rita DeSantis, who will join us for the entire conference and will therefore take the place of Madame Francoeur. And Madame DeSantis is already on the program with Governor Scott at 3 p.m. to make closing remarks. And the second change is in the second panel just before lunch. In the present, the chair, Marie-Claude Franco, not being here, taking her place, will be the Director of Public Affairs for Quebec's delegation in Boston, and that is Madame Marianne Bonnard. So Rita DeSantis and Marianne Bonnard, on vous remercie. Thank you so much. We're delighted to have you both here. And Dean Bill Falls, I'm delighted to have you too. Dean, Bill, the mic is yours.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dave.
Good morning, everyone. As Dave said, I have the pleasure and honor and blessing, actually, to be the Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences here at the University of Vermont, and I am delighted to formally welcome you. This is exactly the kind of conversation the university is proud to convene. Here today, as you know, we will look at the past, the present, and the future of this incredible story. It not only impacts approximately a million immigrants from Quebec who settled in New England, but it also speaks to the waves of immigrants and what they might teach us at the very present with our intense conversation that we're having about immigration right now. My personal immigration story begins actually in Sicily on my mother's side. While I know much less about my paternal grandparents, the family lore is that my grandmother's family immigrated to southern New England from Quebec. My wife's family history is a little more clear and perhaps more relevant to our topic today. She is a native Vermonter, unlike me, I'm a Flatlander. She traces her father's family, the Tremblays, and her maternal grandmother, a Beauregard, who was one of six sisters growing up in Granby, to this immigration wave that we'll learn about and discuss today. The conference organizers have asked me to point out that this conference is much designed to be interactive. Panels will leave time for questions and comment. And a group of students, our very talented UVM students, is pulling people aside to have them tell their own stories. There are a lot of people who made this conference possible, and I'd like just to take a minute to recognize them. They're also recognized on the back page of your program and on the banner that's hanging out on the wall, or it's on the wall right there, actually. First, let me begin by thanking our conference organizers, Professors Dave Massell and Richard Watts. It's both a pleasure and an honor to work with these fine and gifted people. Both exemplify the scholar-teacher that the College of Arts and Sciences at UVM holds so dear. It's their vision and boundless energy that made today's conference possible. I'd also like to recognize our partners and collaborators, including UVM Humanities Center, the Canadian Studies Program, the Center for Research on Vermont, our wonderful History Department, and the Department of Community Development and Applied Economics in the College of Agriculture and Life Science. Beyond UVM, I'd like to thank the state of Vermont Vermont Green Line, the Pomerlo Real Estate Agency for their support and collaboration. Other collaborators include St. Michael's College, the City of Burlington, Paul Franken Collins, the Vermont Academy of Arts and Sciences, the Community College of Vermont, the Alliance Francaise of Lake Champlain Region, the Lake Champlain Regional Chamber of Commerce, and the Franco-American Center at the University of Maine. Our media sponsor today is the Regional Education Television Network. They are providing a complete videotaping of these proceedings, and we are streaming live on Facebook. The website's in your program and also on the banner. I'd also like to recognize the role of our very talented students and the role they've played in putting this all together, working with both David and Richard. The students put together an annotated bibliography of publications on Franco-Americans on the conference website. They greeted you at the front desk. They are pulling people aside for short videos. And the students have set up a social media site, including a Snapchat filter. So go ahead and try that. Finally, I'd like to give a very special thanks to our partners from the government of Quebec. It's been a great experience working with them, and we deeply appreciate their support for this cross-border collaboration. So at this point, please join me in welcoming to the podium Quebec Minister Rita DeSantis.
Dean Falls, distinguished guests and speakers, chers amis, bonjour. C'est un plaisir et un honneur de vous voir si nombreux en ce début de conférence qui s'annonce très intéressant. David Massel and Richard Watts first approached the Quebec government office in Boston with the idea of this conference in the fall of 2015. Although the topic of French-Canadian immigration to New England has often been studied, the angle proposed by David and Richard is innovative and has the potential of bringing the discussion to a level beyond the realm of theoretical Quebec studies. Yes, our economies are growing closer every day, and professors Massel and Watts wanted to host a forum that will help inform about cross-border public policy and economic development. In 2015, we could not have foreseen how timely, how very timely, this event would become in 2017. Last month, Governor Scott met with Premier Couillard, and together they vowed to work closely together on a number of issues, including cross-border trade, innovation, and clean energy. The Franconnexions conference, made possible in part through the Quebec United States University grant program, which promotes academic exchanges between Quebec and the United States, is an example of cross-border dialogue and collaborations to promote and strengthen relations between Quebec and Vermont. I have high hopes that this conference will deepen the bond and understanding between Quebec and Vermont. As we will discuss today, this bond, the shared heritage, and in many ways a shared DNA, and the French language, are and should be leveraged as vectors for our common economic and cultural growth. Excuse me. The topics of immigration, integration, diversity, and inclusion are very dear to my heart. I was 4 1/2 and 58 when I crossed the Atlantic with my parents and my little brother. We arrived in Halifax. We come from Abruzzo in Italy. We came to join the remainder of my mother's family. They were 10 children. My grandparents were the last with us to come from Italy to North America. If we remember, In those days, we didn't go to Canada, we didn't go to Quebec, andavamo in America. Okay. It was all America. And I don't want to take too much time recounting my own story. I represent a riding on the island of Montreal, which is called Bourassa-Sauvé. It is a riding where many immigrants come, live there, settle, before they go on to other areas in Montreal or Quebec. There is la storia dell'immigrante, the story of the immigrant, which repeats itself. I lived it, your grandfather lived it, people who are immigrating to America today are living it. We each have an individual story, but there are many similarities in the storia dell'immigrante. It is important to reflect on that history, but more importantly, it is important to look forwards together, to look forward into the future, and to work together to ensure that our future is the best that it could be for each and every one of us throughout America. I hope we will take the time to exchange with each other and learn about what connects us, about our French connections, because now I too have a French connection. I married someone born in Paris, France. Okay. And we live in Quebec, and we use French as our common language in the home, even though it is my third language. So let's learn about our connections, our French connections, nos franco-connexions. Merci de votre présence. Bonne conférence à toutes et à tous, et bonne journée, et à plus tard.
Thank you. Bonjour. Je m'appelle Suzanne Pinette. My name is Susan Pinette, and I direct Franco-American programs at the University of Maine in Orono. I would like to thank both David Massel and Richard Watts on behalf of our panel for their invitation to be here today. We are all honored to be able to share this day with you. In most conferences, my role as panel chair would consist of introducing the panelists. This time around, you've been supplied with our bios, so I can use these initial minutes to offer a few framing remarks. My first remark concerns the title, French Connections, Franconnexions. Now, growing up Franco-American, my family and I always referred to ourselves as French, not Franco-American. And I think this is the case for most, if not all, the different Franco-American communities across New England. David Plant is from Rhode Island. So about whom are we talking in Vermont and in New England when we talk about French connections? Specifically, we are talking about people of French-Canadian and Acadian descent living in the United States. And the University of Maine worked with the state of government to do a poll about 4 or 5 years ago of Franco-Americans. We polled 600 Franco-Americans, and we asked them specifically about their heritage, and only about 1% said they were from France. Everyone else who said they were French or Franco-American or kind of put themselves either as French-Canadian or Acadian. So when we're talking about French connections, what we're talking about is connections to French-speaking Canada. And when we look at the most recent census numbers from New England, we're talking about 24% of Vermonters, the result of a massive migration from French Canada, La Grande Saignée, as it was called at the time, right? And I always find these kind of statistics so striking. One in three in 1901, one in three French Canadians were living in the United States. That's an entire third of their population. Right? My students always find it fascinating that Fall River was the third largest French-Canadian city in importance at the time. So my second remark concerns the question of history. This is a panel of historians. We're talking about the past. Why is this history important? Why does it still matter today? Most obviously, this history explains the continued presence of the French language in New England and in Vermont. And this comes from the most recent census data. This is the most prevalent language after English in these states. And we can see that, you know, French is the most prevalent language. And it is the most prevalent language in Maine and Vermont, and it's the second in New Hampshire. Right? These Franco-American communities constitute one of the largest French-speaking community in the United States. Equally important, however, the history of Franco-Americans offers us alternatives to current polemics. And as I think it's already been mentioned, it's very polemical right now. U.S. history often omits French Canadians and Franco-Americans. Despite their numerical significance, Franco-Americans have been referred to as the quiet presence. That's the name of one book about Franco-Americans, the quiet presence. And another one is called the hidden minority. Right? Franco-Americans are rarely included in literature dedicated to the teaching of white ethnicity or in studies of white ethnic communities in the United States. Not a single Franco-American text, for example, is included in a recent multilingual anthology of American literature published by a Harvard professor, even though the first Franco-American text, Jean La Fileuse, was published in French in 1878 in Fall River, Massachusetts. Franco-American migrations, for the most part, are excluded from most recent major works on 19th century migration, mainly because their migration patterns do not fit into current research paradigms. The French historian François Veil calls this an étonnant mutisme. On the other side, Quebec history as well often overlooks Franco-Americans. Historian Bruno Ramirez calls it a historiographical desert, arguing that historians are reluctant to talk about the massive departures of their citizens, who often were forced to do so by economic oppression and political injustice. Perhaps national pride prevents acknowledging collective abandonment. Franco-Americans are left out of these histories because they disturb the simple story. They don't easily fit in to the national meta-narrative. They disrupt the facile, uncomplicated narration of assimilation into the melting pot, instead showing us the ways in which ethnic identity persists, how the Franco-American community, to borrow Mark Richards' title, sees itself as both French and American, right? Loyal but French. It also shows, different from Quebec, how Franco-Americans continue to remember, je me souviens, but in a different way from Quebec. Franco-Americans, even though they may no longer speak French as their native tongue, nevertheless continue to signify Frenchness, as Abby Page does in the end of her poem, The Undefended Border, and Abby Page is a poet from Vermont. Franco-Americans show us things about identity, about immigration, about language, about belonging, and they do it in such a way to offer alternate ways into contemporary political debates. And it is for this that French connections are important in the past, in the present, and in the future. All right, thank you. So I think we start with you.
I'm Marcel Rainville. I'm at St. Mike's. When I was asked to be on this panel by Richard Watts' wife, who has her office next to mine, I thought that I might share some memories about growing up in Vermont on a farm in Swanton, plus maybe retell a story or two that my father would recount while we waited for the cows to finish milking, and before we dumped the milk in the the bulk tank in the milk house. Before I do that, I want to acknowledge my two main sources for some of the things I'll be saying. First is, thank you. It's called the Boucher Heritage. It's not in print at the moment, but it's written by Laurent Boucher, who was my father's first cousin. My grandmother, whom you see here in this picture on the right, seated, was Imelda Boucher. Some of you may be familiar with the Boucher farm, family farm in Highgate, and their famous cheeses, Boucher Bleu, Gorgonzola, and Brother Laurent cheeses, the last one being named after the author of the family history. My father is the shortest person in this picture, the one, of the men that is, the one in the center of this family picture. An aside, does anyone know where the name Gorgonzola comes from, originates? The Zola, maybe, yes. But the Boucher farm is located on the Gore Road in Highgate. Don is the wife of Dan, and Don is the one who came up with and developed this cottage industry for the family. So Gore Don Zola. The second person I am indebted to is Claude Magnan, who's done wonderful genealogical work for the family, both on the Bouchers and the Rainvilles, my paternal side, but also on the Boudreaux and Fournier families on my mother's side. Here you have a picture of my mother's family. My mother is the one seated on the left, and there's only one surviving member of that family, my aunt, who's in the middle in the back, who was a nun in Buffalo. Now I introduce you to Lucille and Morris Rainville on their wedding day, May 1943. Lucille and Morris settled on a dairy farm in Swanton, a farm Morris had purchased the same year from Ernest Holmes. An interesting note about the farm is that in a deed dating back to 7 March 1866, you find an Ephraim Holmes, Ernest's father, having purchased the farm from Daniel and Maria Walker. And at that time, it was encumbered by, quote, a mortgage on the north side of said farm to Ira H. Allen of Irisburg of $1,000 to interest annually. The next two photos are of some of my siblings and me. In the first one, from left to right, in descending order, there's myself, my sisters Yvette, Lise, Claire, and Marie-Paul, our brother Mark, spelled with a C, and our sister Jeanne. The next less mutilated photo is of us sans Yvette and Claire. And these photos were taken by Jack Klecka, who was the first Ferguson, eventually Massey Ferguson, tractor dealer in Franklin County. I can never forget how old I was when the picture was taken because it was the year I got my first bike. You see in the background there, 1955, I was 11 years old. Growing up in Swanton, especially in the 40s and 50s, meant that basically you did not need to know English until you got to first grade. Our social community consisted mainly of neighbors who spoke French, plus relatives, grandparents, aunts, uncles, cousins, whose dominant language was French. Pa, our dad, was jealous of our French heritage, simply would not tolerate hearing English being spoken in the home, even though he and my mother did speak it. It was as if he made a minor crusade of keeping us connected with our linguistic and cultural roots. I remember well walking the streets of St. Albans, or going to the store or baseball game in Highgate and feeling like you really did not need to know English. To a certain degree, I think church helped to sustain the illusion we could stay French. Technically, our family belonged to the Swanton Church. However, my earliest memories of church were of standing on the kneeler, peeking over the pew at the Holy Angels Church in St. Albans. Now, I'm not sure why my father first wanted us to go to a church that was not our own parish church. We had all been christened in Swanton. He did business in St. Albans at the co-op, and the city had more and better stores in Swanton. There was also the fact that Holy Angels was a little bit closer than the Swanton Church, but even though we had all been christened in the Swanton Church, Pa preferred Holy Angels. And maybe it had to do with the fact that the preaching there was in French. It turns out it was only when we started to go to the parochial school in Swanton that he decided to switch churches. He once said that the Swanton pastor had told him, if you're going to have your children here, you'll need to put your envelope offering in the basket here. I suppose that was only fair. All of us siblings attended the parochial school in Swanton, where practically all our classes were taught in English, except that for grades 3, 4, and 5, families were given the option of having their children receive their catechism lessons in French. My father insisted that I do so. So Rachel, Lucie, and I were the only ones who got the lesson in French. I can't imagine how disruptive this must have been for Sister Philemon, who had to take time out away from the other kids to go over the material with these two oddballs whose families insisted that they get the instruction in French. So these two stories kind of underscore my father's penchant to preserve and pass on something that was obviously dear to him. One of the fondest memories I have of chore times was of my dad telling stories of his growing up in Highgate. My father was a good storyteller, and besides the unforgettable stories about Prohibition and the Depression times, he would recount what farm work was like, especially working with horses, animal husbandry, and the business of selling hay, which was the real economic mainstay of my grandfather's farm. In the Prohibition stories, he'd even name some of the people who were into bootlegging and rum running. Sometimes these happened to be relatives. As you know, I'm in the confession business, but I never really wanted to probe too deeply about how close the smuggling got to our immediate family. Now, my father's stories included some about people who'd become alcoholic and whose lives were practically ruined due to the activity they had engaged in. I enjoyed the story about Mr. Bior from Highgate Falls, who had a small transport business and used to bus the well-heeled flatlanders from New York, Connecticut, and other points south to stay at hotels and inns in St. Albans and or at the falls, and from which he'd take them to the watering holes just across the border. My father's family had front row seats, so to speak, as the family farmhouse was literally less than a half a mile from the border near Morse's line. My father told of the sometimes unsightly scenes of inebriated people making their way back to the bus that took them again to the places where they were staying at the Falls or in St. Albans. Other stories were about rum runners trying to outwit and outrun the law. It seems one especially colorful guy used to make enough money on a few, say four or five runs, that he could afford to forfeit his car if the cops got too close, and he needed to jump out and outrun them through the fields, the woods, or whatever. Then he'd buy another car and start over again. Other stories were about what it was like growing up on the farm. His father, Théophile, can go back to the first photo. This picture here on the left, seated on the left. Théophile, my pépère, had acquired the farm in 1911. Théophile, who also went by the nickname Tanis, or Tanis, apparently from his middle name Stanislas, had owned a small 62-acre farm in Quebec in the village of Saint-Sabin, near Pike River, for those who know a bit of the cross-border geography. It was a small operation, and it seems he worked a few winters in the textile mills in Putnam, Connecticut, when he was first married in the early 1900s to supplement his meager income from the Quebec farm. In 1909, he moved to Franklin to the Felton farm, and then in 11, he bought a 326-acre farm from Mr. Pierre Ferland, which was a big farm by the standards of the day. It's considered the original homestead by all his progenies. My father claimed that whereas his own father was proud of his hay business, he liked cows and milk production more, and working the fields with the teams of horses for the planting and harvesting. He'd say quite frankly that his father was not a good herdsman, though he did well selling hay. My father and his brothers would truck hay to places as far as Morrisville and to the cavalry stables at Fort Ethan Allen in the early 30s. Most of my father's siblings did grade school in Saint-Armand, Quebec. They walked over the border to and from school. He tells a story that after finishing the sixth grades of elementary school at Saint-Armand, he would have been about 12 years old in 1927. My Pepe told him that it might be a good thing if he went to the one-room English schoolhouse down the road, not far from the original Felton farm Pepe had acquired years earlier. This is where my father did grades 7 and 8. He'd say that his father had told him, "Il paraît qu'on va rester ici et pas retourner au Canada," meaning that he had finally decided to settle in Vermont, that it would be a good thing if my father learned some English. Implied, Pepe had still harbored ideas of maybe going back to his roots in Saint-Sabin. Oops. My father's not doing well, by the way. This is a picture of him on his 100th birthday, almost two years ago. And so keep him in your thoughts and your prayers. Thank you.
We're going to be going now from the individual to the macro, and I'm going to give you a big overview of French Canadian migration into New England. As you've already heard this morning by the numbers, French Canadians are one of the most significant immigrant groups of the 19th and 20th centuries. Actually surpassed only by the Irish, Italians, and Eastern Europeans. So between 1840 and 1930, about 1 million French Canadians immigrated to the United States, and over two-thirds of them came here to New England. The rest went mostly to the Midwest and West. Today, also about 10% of that million came to Vermont, about 100,000. Today, more than 3 million Americans, including one of every 4 to 5 New Englanders and Vermonters, are of French Canadian descent. So I want to just give you a quick sense of how and why did they come. Traditionally, historians have emphasized the negative when discussing the causes of French Canadian migration. Huge families led to rural overpopulation, they told us. Backward farming techniques meant unrelenting poverty and debt. Like all stereotypes, this picture contains a grain of truth. Quebec farm families were indeed large by today's standards. My own immigrant great-great-grandfather, Joseph Hector Choquette, was one of 6 children. His father, Étienne Choquette, was one of 10. His grandfather, Pierre Choquette, was one of 17, all with the same mother, believe it or not. We need to recognize, though, that big families were the rule in North America before industrialization because family farms required family labor. The birth rate in 19th century Quebec was actually similar to general birth rates in other parts of Canada and in the United States. In fact, in 1871, which was about the time that my great-great-grandfather left, Quebec's birth rate was lower than Ontario's, even though most of Ontario's population was of British origin. So there wasn't anything that unusual about Quebec's big farm families. As for rural misery, here too the story is more complex. Quebec's transition to commercial farming caused farm size to increase and rural society to grow more stratified in the 19th century. Some habitants benefited from the change, doubling their productivity and enjoying a good standard of living. Dairy farmers outside Montreal did particularly well. So as Father Marcel was telling us, the ability to go from like a small 60-acre farm to buy a 360-acre farm, you could make a living. On the other hand, smaller farms were ceasing to be viable. A large population of landless day laborers emerged, and the remaining smallholders found it increasingly hard to make ends meet. Migration then was less a product of rural backwardness than a response to agricultural modernization and change. And that, by the way, was also true of a lot of rural immigrants who were leaving Europe for North America at the same time. The first wave of French Canadian immigrants, however, came not for economic, but for political reasons. Discontent with the colonial government, Quebec had been a British colony since 1763, culminated in the Patriot Rebellions of 1837 and 1838, which were particularly intense in the countryside around and south of Montreal. Radical patriots authored a Declaration of Independence calling for republican government, bilingualism, universal male suffrage, freedom of the press, and separation of church and state. Martial law was proclaimed in 1837 after a series of pitched battles. This portrays one of them, the Battle of Saint-Eustache. And the British Army put down the rebellion by force. 12 patriots were hanged, 58 were deported to penal colonies in Australia, and 1,000 were imprisoned. Many more fled on foot or by horse and buggy to the United States, especially nearby Vermont and New York. They would soon be joined by economic migrants,
usually young men with a sense of adventure. The Civil War was a watershed event for French Canadian immigration to the United States. This bloody conflict put 4 million men into battle and cost the lives of 600,000. It also triggered a mass migration of French Canadians that would last until the Great Depression of the 1930s. Nearly 20,000 French Canadians served in the Union Army between 1861 and 1865. They volunteered either from their new homes in the U.S., where tens of thousands already lived. That's the case of Joseph François d'Avignon, whom you're looking at. He was a doctor from Iberville. He had been a militant patriote during the rebellions. He was arrested, and he escaped to New York with a price on his head and enlisted in the Civil War from New York, served as a surgeon, was a prisoner of war for a while, and became a hero of the American Civil War. Some French Canadians, however, enlisted in Quebec, where U.S. Army recruiters were plying their trade in defiance of British law. British law forbade British subjects, and of course Canadians were British subjects, from serving in foreign armies, but the U.S. recruiters were coming up and doing it anyway. Soldiers and sailors were not the only French Canadians to reach the U.S. during the Civil War. The mill owners of industrializing New England, facing labor shortages caused by the draft, also began recruiting aggressively in the Quebec countryside, where the lure of higher wages combined with the troubles of small and landless farmers to launch the mass migration. The movement was facilitated by the railways, which connected the U.S. to Canada by the 1850s. Between 1860 and 1900, New England's French Canadian population jumped from 37,000 to 573,000. Vermont's from 16,000 to 45,000. Because of Western migration by Vermont farm families, the state's population would have declined in the 19th century without French Canadian immigration. Many immigrants ended up in major industrial centers like Fall River, Massachusetts, Lewiston, Maine, Woonsocket, Rhode Island, and Manchester, New Hampshire. But French Canadians found their way to smaller towns and mill villages as well. The Franco-American Monument in Quebec City, a gift of Franco-Americans to the people of Quebec for the city's 400th anniversary in 2008. It's in a beautiful site right along the river, as you can see in the Sillery section of Quebec City. This monument, which was organized by my colleague Claire Quintal, who is shown unveiling it with then Premier Jean Charest. Claire had put onto the monument 168 New England communities that were important migrant destinations, including 21 in Vermont. And that list is nowhere near exhaustive. Claire said that picking the 168 that were going to go on the monument was a real headache because people were always turning to her and saying, well, why aren't you going to put mine on? In New England, French Canadians worked mainly in construction and in the rapidly expanding shoe and textile industries. This picture was taken by the same photographer who took the picture that's on the cover of our programs, and it's from the Chase Cotton Mill right here in Burlington. In Vermont, French Canadian immigrants also bought farms, like Father Marcel's family, as Yankee farmers moved west. And some French Canadians came to work in the quarries beginning in the 1920s. Middle-class French Canadians immigrated as well to take advantage of commercial and professional opportunities. After the Civil War, French Canadian immigration increasingly became a family affair, hence the young boy working in the cotton mill in the picture. Whole families rather than single young men. The decision to move was made as a family with every member weighing in, women often taking the initiative, and the ability of children to earn a wage in the mills obviously being a factor. Destinations were chosen thanks to the presence there of family and friends. Before long, there were full-fledged networks linking communities on both sides of the border, a phenomenon known as chain migration. For example, immigrants to the Blackstone Valley from Worcester, Massachusetts, down to Pawtucket, Rhode Island, often came from the Richelieu Valley in southern Quebec and the St. Lawrence Valley east of Montreal. That is true of my great-great-grandfather who moved from Marieville, Quebec. Marieville is actually not on the map, it's too small, but it's north of Saint-Jean-sur-Richelieu, and if you just follow the river up on the eastern side, and it's a little bit south of Montreal on that side of the river. And he, like many others, ended up in the Blackstone Valley in Central Falls, Rhode Island, just north of Pawtucket. And I was actually born in Pawtucket almost a century later in 1956. However, before going to Rhode Island, my great-great-grandfather stopped off first in Vermont. Around 1870, he married a Burlington woman of French-Canadian ancestry, and their first child was born in Woodstock. So Burlington, Woodstock, and then down to the Blackstone Valley. Stepwise migration like this was common, and Vermont was often the first landing place due to its familiarity and proximity. And I just have one more picture. That's the train station in Marieville, where my great-great-grandfather came from. So I think my 10 minutes are up, but that's the migration pattern in a nutshell. Thank you.
And so if you have a comment or a question, we would simply ask that you use the mic, that you stand and briefly introduce yourself, and you can raise your hand and Susan will take care of it from here.
Thank you very much. My name is François, and I just have a simple question. After this exodus from Canada into New England, why did the French Canadians stay here? Why didn't they go back into Quebec or wherever they came from? Because there was no mention of that.
Many did go back. However, they came for jobs to improve their way of life, and like all immigrants, like immigrants today, most don't come with the intention of returning. It was easier to return if you were from Quebec because it was so close, you could just hop on the train. But Father Marcel said, you know, it took his pépé a while to decide, you know what, we're living well here, we're going to stay.
My name is Paul. I grew up in Winooski, just a few blocks from the woolen mill, and I'd like you to comment on the impact of the closing of the woolen mills and perhaps other industries in New England. For example, the Winooski woolen mill closed around 1952, I believe. To what extent were French Canadians affected by the closing of the woolen mills?
I researched something similar for the community of Lewiston, Maine, and what I discovered is that in the mills where French Canadians often were able to speak French with co-workers, that a lot of them ended up moving into service jobs where they needed English to be able to perform their functions. So it helped promote the acculturation and assimilation of a lot of French Canadians in the 50s and 60s.
My name is Suzanne, and I grew up in Burlington. And I was just wondering if the Klan also went after Irish Catholics, not just French Canadian.
Yes, it went after all Catholics.
Okay.
But Catholics that didn't speak English were an even bigger target. Yeah. So.
Yes. Kosai Samak, University of Montreal. I have a question about what was the cementing element that that linked the population that came from La Nouvelle France and so on to the civic culture in America? Was it primarily religious, Catholic, or was it a Republican, not in the sense of the political party, but American Republicanism that is anti-British, despotic, etc., etc.? Which side was it the connection, civic connection between French Canadians originally, who became Franco-Americans, and American civic culture?
Well, you have, I'm going to let Mark talk about this as well, but you have an ethnic leadership that is imbued with the ideology of la survivance, which was obviously the dominant form of French Canadian nationalism, and they do bring that with them. However, it also does not exclude a desire to acculturate, as Mark has shown in his work. And he mentioned the Wright Report. Well, the Wright Report that said that French Canadians were a horde of industrial invaders and they weren't educating their children and they were just, you know, incorrigible. It outraged the Franco-American leadership. They convinced Carol Wright to convene a hearing in which he heard testimony about assimilation, about naturalization, and so forth. At the end of the hearing, Wright, who was an intelligent and open-minded man, said, "Wow, you guys have convinced me I was completely wrong. You are assimilating just like good other immigrants, and you're going to be good Americans, and I'm thrilled." Well, it turns out that he was right, but then Franco-American leaders were even more angry at his apology. So they were able to be loyal, but French.
No, I was just going to add that by the 1890s, the term Franco-American came about, and on St. Jean-Baptiste Day, celebrated in different communities throughout New England, they would carry banners that said, "Loyaux mais Français."
Susan Munkris here at the University of Vermont. I'm curious about whether there's anything distinctive about assimilation in rural areas on farms, because looking at those numbers, it's clear that Vermont had perhaps a smaller proportion of French Canadians because we did not have major industrial centers. But what were the impacts of, say, growing up rural and isolated on maintaining your language as opposed to in small towns where there might have been more pressure to assimilate?
I don't think we have enough case studies to be able to answer that well.
Anecdotally, I can tell you I have 9 sisters and they all married into English families. Except for one who's a nun.
Hi, I was just curious if you had examples of sort of more genteel forms of discrimination, denying French Canadians admittance into social organizations or higher education, things of that nature?
Yes, we have many examples of that. Examples where they were pressured in schools, for example, to learn English. There are often many stories where young children French-speaking children would wet themselves because they didn't know how to ask in English how to go to the restroom. So there are all kinds of stories like this.
And in Maine, there were English, I don't know about Vermont, maybe you know, but there were English-only laws on the book and books until the 1970s, I think, is when it was, is that right?
Vermont and Massachusetts were the only two states that did not have those English-only laws, but the other New England states did.
Yeah, so in Massachusetts, a lot of the French-Canadian parish schools were actually bilingual. They would have French half the day and English half the day.
Hi, Sheila from Winooski in Burlington, 100% French-Canadian with no French. And my question is about chain migration. And I understand that prior to the time periods that we've been speaking about this morning, that Vermont was actually part of Quebec, and that border between the United States and Canada had been moving, was moving south and north. So my feeling was that there were likely some French in Vermont and other parts of New England prior to the time periods and these migrations, and this chain migration concept might relate back to that. And I was wondering if someone could comment on that.
The moving border is very much part of Maine's history as well, because it doesn't get set until, what, 1846 or something like that. There was a commission, it did strand some people on one side or the other, but the border remained porous for quite a while. I think the chain migration, we see it even with very distant migrations, you know, some little village in southeast Poland and some particular destination in the U.S. So it's just kind of the way migrations work.
So we have about another 10 minutes, is that right, David? And lots of questions. So this is, I'm just going to jump around. And for those in the back, there are a couple seats in the back, but we're just going to jump around this mic as quick as we can.
Hi, my name is Caroline Damour, and I'm from Boston University. I want to know a little bit more about the assimilation process. What about the Second World War? Probably would be a lot disruptive process for a lot of French American, and a lot of men and go into the army. What do you have to say about that? Thanks.
That did help promote assimilation as people went to moved out of their Petit Canadas into the larger world. A number of them found that their French language skills were especially helpful in France, and that helped bring about some cohesion in the group. So perhaps it had both elements to the war promoted acculturation, but at the same time promoted ethnic pride as well in some respects.
And also the GI Bill after the war allowed them to get higher education, which helped assimilate them.
And also move out into the suburbs, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, there was housing assistance, too, as part mm-hmm. of that.
Yes, picking up on this gentleman behind me asked the question about the glue that kind of held things together. My name is Joe Sherman. I grew up in the Upper Valley, and my parents were in the woolen mills. And I went to school in Lebanon, and I always wondered, the Catholic Church was the largest building in town. We had Catholic schools that closed shortly after I was out of school. But I wondered where the money came from. There was a lot of money that built a Catholic infrastructure for these people. And as you said, they didn't have the money. Was there an identified kind of cash flow from the larger Catholic world to help build these this infrastructure? Thank you.
No, it came from the nickels and dimes of the parishioners.
Hi, my name is Paul Rushlow, and I took a course years ago with Andre Senecal called Franco-Americans in New England, and I seem to remember reading an article about eugenics playing a role in the challenges that the Franco-Americans faced. Can you talk a little bit about that?
I haven't researched that, but when I was here at the University of Vermont doing a little bit of research for my book on the Klan, I came across an article in the Special Collections in Bailey Howe Library that indicated that French Canadian immigrants were among the targets of the eugenics movement that existed here in Vermont.
Yeah, the other targets were Native Americans. Those were the people that they were trying to weed out.
That mic went back up, yes. Hi, I'm Liz Duclos-Arcello from Salem State University, and I just wanted to ask quickly if you had anything to say about sojourner migration as another pattern, the notion of coming, staying for a bit of time with the intent to try to take money earned and go back. And I know there are enough families in New England, particularly northern New England, for whom that was the case, and perhaps it worked back in Quebec province, and perhaps it did not. So people actually going back and forth.
That is often the first thing that they do. And I know anecdotally from a number of family stories that I've heard that it was hard on the family. They could do that in Quebec, too. They could go up to the lumber camps for the winter. But that separation from family was difficult. So I know one friend's grandfather had come down to Maine to work in the lumber camps from New Brunswick. He just decided he didn't like that separation, so he brought the whole family down to Gardner, Mass, and took a job in the mills. And so often the sojourner migration pretty quickly. Also stories about people who were going down working seasonally in the brickyards in Brooklyn, New York, leaving the wife in charge of all the farm work and the kids, and doing temporary sewing at home for a Montreal factory, and she was the one who said, "Now this is going to stop." And the whole family got on the train and went down to Lewiston. So
that seems to.
Hi, my name is Paul D'Amboise. I was born in New Hampshire, from Quebec immigrants to New Hampshire. I live just outside of Montreal, but I teach at Community College of Vermont, so I'm a bit of. My question is, issues about immigration today are often dominated about notions of refusing to integrate into the larger population, maintaining traditions from back home, wherever back home might be. And growing up at the very tail end of French-Canadian migration into New England, there was still this idea of having, you know, French language churches, and the French language parochial school closed the year before I started. So I'm wondering, this idea of assimilation is often seen as a positive in some areas, but negative by the part of the population that wants to preserve its tradition. So what kind of reception were French Canadian immigrants to New England in the late 19th and early 20th century with their insistence on creating a Petit Canada, as you've mentioned? So how did that fit in with the larger goal of integrating into society? And did they face the same kinds of prejudices that people face today who are coming from bringing their own language, religion, and so on that's not of the majority?
Well, in my research on Lewiston, Maine, I discovered that they face the same kinds of pressures that many face today, but they maintain an identity that was both French and Canadian, both French and American, and they referred to themselves as Franco-Americans beginning in the 1890s. And continuing at least to the Second World War, and maintain their French language, Roman Catholic faith, French Canadian traditions, while becoming Americans. And they felt that they could be both. They had an intertwined identity.
I think, though, that insistence on la survivance, which obviously came from the Quebec experience, was not as functional an ideology for the ethnic group in terms of having political clout. Because if you look at, say, the way Italians or the way Irish integrated, well, the Irish didn't have the language issue, but the Italians did. And they knew they were here to stay and basically focused on integration, whereas the Franco-American leadership had much of their head in Quebec, so that they could be, when they convinced Carol Wright that they were indeed assimilating like other immigrants, and he said that to and apologized, they were even angrier. So I think that one of the reasons for invisibility, one of the reasons for less political clout, is that the leadership was torn between really becoming fully American and having this nostalgic sense of a Chateau Fort and remaining French Canadian.
I am Michael, a history teacher, and next month, as we mark the 100th anniversary of America's entry into World War I, there were many accompanying changes with immigration and naturalization that impacted Vermonters. Many 19th century Vermonters came and went with no trace of them at the border, and that would all change in the 20th century. There are many case studies of men in Vermont lining up to get naturalized in 1917 and 1918, and there are many examples also of people being stuck at the border that could not gain entry back in the United States because they were not able to read and write in the English language. So there's an opportunity for us to consider many case studies of people being stuck and not being able to return home. And the digitization of those records can give a lot of us good anecdotal evidence on families that we're researching.
How do they say that? Deja vu all over again?
Hi, Jess Robinson, Vermont Division for Historic Preservation. I'm just wondering, with Vermont's, and particularly the Champlain Valley's, rich 17th and 18th century French history and French occupation and settlement here, did that factor into anyone's perception in the migrations of the 1800s or early 1900s? Was there an affinity to this former colony, or was it purely economic?
I think it was more economic and geographic, obviously. Proximity mattered, but I don't think Champlain particularly. These were not highly educated people.
We're going to go over here, and we just have time for a few more, but yes, somebody over here has a mic. Yeah.
My name is Judy Dow. I was born and raised in Burlington, and I am descendant of the largest family targeted by the Vermont Eugenics Survey. Yes, religion did play a big part of that. My question is, in 1890, Quebec passed a law, to the law of 12 children, and they had a payment. How much did that payment impact the migration from Quebec to Vermont?
I'm not aware of it.
The law of 12 children? No? Well, so they increased the payment to $100, which back then was $10,000. And there, if you look at the names of the people who received those payments, you will see this huge influx of those families into Vermont, New Hampshire, and Maine. So I think the payment was critical to part of the migration as well.
Stan Bradeen. One of the things that surprises me oftentimes is our lack of knowledge, not just about the French-Canadian immigration, but about our politics between, which was, shall we say, at best ambiguous, because there were guns run from Vermont to support the Patriots. There were Saint-Jean-Baptiste Society members here, and yet at the same time, the United States was quote-unquote independent. And that really teaches us an awful lot, not just about the past, but of our current ambiguous actions. And yet it's part of our history, whether it's French history or American history, that very few people know. And I'm curious why we can all provide our current answers why we don't do that. But it's something that maybe should be done.
Bill Bittinger, Hanover, New Hampshire. My question has to do with chain migration and the question raised about potentially interest in reverse migration. Could one of you address the context of the province of Quebec during this 90-year period during which 1 million French Canadians crossed into New England? What was happening with population patterns there? Were French moving into Quebec in equal numbers, or perhaps you could just address that subject, please.
Yeah, I tried to touch on that. The population was growing. There was industrialization going on in Quebec, mostly Montreal, but it wasn't enough to absorb the whole surplus. And as I said, commercial farming was really changing the farming scene. Subsistence farming was becoming less and less viable. Commercial farmers were doing okay, but those who lost out were not. You had a population of landless laborers for the first time. So you had an economic situation that was changing and which people needed to move for jobs.
So I think, actually, we're going to stop there. We're here all day, so all our panelists are here all day, so lots of time for interaction. We're going to take a 20-minute coffee break and reconvene back here at 10:35. A big round of applause for our first panelists.